Well, I've been photographing abandoned places for like 40 years. The beginning is just a photographing the building. And then it turns into a big Alice in Wonderland rabbit hole of what happened here.
What Phil Buehler found out about Greystone Park Psychiatric Hospital was that Woody Guthrie, the famous Dust Bowl balladeer, spent time here.
I've sung this song, but I'll sing it again, of the place that I lived on the wild windy plains in the month called April, county called Gray, and here's what all of the people there say. So long, it's been good to know you. So
in 1956, Guthrie was picked up for vagrancy in Morristown. He was misdiagnosed as schizophrenic and committed to Greystone. Woody Guthrie actually had Huntington's, a genetic disease once called the shakes.
And then I also discovered that there was a Woody Guthrie Archives in New York City, not far from where I lived. And I made an appointment and went in and met Nora Guthrie, Woody's daughter. And then she kind of opened up the archives for me. And so I would read Woody's letters from the hospital. And they would all be signed Ward 40 or Wardy 40.
I remember when I first saw the pictures, I thought that they were a mirror image of my memories of my dad, in a way, as if the hospital was the man and the man was the hospital. So the wall was up in the hospital, but the paint's peeling. The bed's still there, but the mattress has fallen. The file cabinets were still there, but the drawers are open and the papers are flying out. And it's that in-between land. It's not life and it's not death. It's just this weird, the time it takes to deteriorate. That became the metaphor. I kept looking at it and saying, for all the years my dad, from the first time he entered the hospital, those 15 years until the day he died, it was all downhill, 15 years of just, whoa, every day. And I looked at those pictures of Phil's and I said, the same thing was happening with the building. What's happening to my dad. And I thought it was a beautiful metaphor in a way. What happens when something takes a very, very long time to fade?
Greystone Park was home to tens of thousands of patients for well over 100 years before finally closing in 2008.
This building, the trees there, they've been there since 1875. You know, it was built after the Civil War when everybody came back with shell shock, you know, post-traumatic stress disorder, we'd call it today, from the Civil War. Up until then, if you had mental illness, you were put in a county jail. And this was the first humane treatment of the mentally ill.
The future of Greystone Park is uncertain. Some want to preserve what's left, others to tear it down.
Well, the hospital used to have 8,500 patients and 40, 50 buildings, and most of them in been torn down now. Right behind me was where the clinic building used to be, which was a general hospital on the grounds of the hospital. And that's where Woody was from 1960 to maybe 61. You know, they've all been demolished to make room for ball fields. These buildings all come down eventually, or they get restored. And in either case, there's something there to be rescued before it's all gone. Once I found Woody was here, I actually found Woody's mugshot, you know, his intake and discharge photos in the basement of one of the abandoned buildings. And he would write letters about looking out the window at the exercise yard with all the other patients that he's there with. And you can look out that window now. And then to actually walk, you know, read in his letters where he's talking about the paintings on the walls of his hospital ward. They're still there. If you were able to get inside, on the walls are these big murals from the 30s that somebody painted.
Look at that, it's got the cyclone. Woody wrote a lot of songs, and actually one of the chapters in Bound for Glory is about the cyclone. I mean, this could have been an illustration for Bound for Glory, or for the Grapes of Wrath. It looks like the Jode family, you know, coming out with this, with the Dust Bowl and the cyclones coming into the... Phil did all the research on the papers and everything that we had in the archives. He spent a lot of time up in the archives looking through hospital records, letters, notebooks, diaries, and things to see what Woody had produced during that time.
Woody wrote to Jody saying, I see lots of good pictures hand-painted hung up here along my Greystone Hospital walls.
Part of what Nora Guthrie does at Woody Guthrie Publications is keep the spirit and the advocacy of her father alive.
In a way, he is very much alive, particularly because a lot of the work that we do here is creating new projects based on materials that he left unfinished for some reason in some way, mostly because of Huntington's disease. He developed Huntington's disease relatively early in his life when he was around 40 years old. So the vast majority of the works that you know about, whether it's This Land Is Your Land or Pastures of Plenty or any of the songs that he wrote, were things that he created and recorded before he was 40 years old, basically.
This land is your land, and this land is my land.
We found over 3,000 lyrics that he had written and sung, but never recorded. So it came upon me to find contemporary musicians to set a lot of those lyrics to music, which is what I've done with bands like Wilco, Billy Bragg.
I lived in a place called Ofusky, and I had a little girl in a holler tree.
So many people, Madeline Peru, I've worked with Lou Reed. So I've had the honor of not just restoring, you know, not just making history, but creating a new part of the history, which is what I did with Philip Buehler for Wardy 40, was to tell some stories that people hadn't heard before.
On Sundays, Marjorie Guthrie and the three kids would drive out to visit Woody at Greystone.
It's funny, I first learned about the tree when I talked to Arlo about, you know, he'd been back to Greystone. He didn't go back to Greystone to see the buildings at all.
Crops are rolling,
he went back to see the tree.
The beaches are rotting. The oranges are piled in their creosote.
Told me a story about how he took the tour bus. They were touring in New Jersey, and he had a whole tour bus with musicians, and they're driving around the back roads of New Jersey looking for the tree, and they came into Greystone from the other side. It's this huge campus. And they find, oh, there it is, stop the bus.
That river. They took all
this
the money.
Huge, you know, 150-year-old weeping beach. And in the summertime, the leaves are just covered it, and it's a canopy. And you can go inside, and it's kind of like almost like a clubhouse. You can climb into it and kind of really pretty special. And so they were able to turn, you know, a trip out here into something a little bit more fun for the family. Well, if you can say fun would be, I don't know if that would be the word, but something a little more special.
This project was a way of explaining what I think of as lost years. So a lot of the biographies, they kind of dropped off a cliff when he gets sick. And then it's like, and then he got sick, he was in the hospital for 15 years, and then he died. And then there's Bob Dylan and all these other stories that people talk about. But I thought, that's really disregarding so many days in a person's life. And he was writing throughout those days. He was fighting every single day to keep busy, to keep sane, to keep healthy. And I thought that's his courage, actually, should be noted.
It was while Woody Guthrie was at Greystone that a very young Bob Dylan made a pilgrimage to meet him.
Hey, hey, Woody Guthrie, I wrote you a song about a funny old world that's a-coming along.
If this building is torn down and this is just a field, you won't have these memories. You won't even have this. Nobody will be here telling this story. It'll be gone.
Now, as I look around, it's mighty plain to see. This world is such a great and a funny place to be. All the gambling man is rich and the working man is poor, and I ain't got no home in this world anymore.